On this episode of Aquatic Adventures, we visit Seattle.
The bluest skies you've ever seen are in Seattle. And the hills, the greenest green in Seattle. Like a beautiful child.
The Puget Sound is home to whales, seals, and salmon. Today, we're exploring the tide pool at Alki Beach. Just what is a tide pool? Let's find out. Tides are the movement of water. When it is high tide, the water is high and close to the beach. At low tide, the water recedes. This pattern of high tide and then low tide happens all the time. The ocean tides are constantly shifting from high tide to low tide and then high tide to low tide. This happens about every 6 hours. When it is low tide, some of the water is trapped in holes or crevices. And this creates tide pools. Organisms that live near the shore live in water during high tide. When it is low tide, tide pool organisms are exposed to the open air. Today, we'll explore what organisms live in this tide pool ecosystem, and we'll learn about how they are adapted to survive in this ever-changing environment. We are exploring this tide pool during a low tide. This makes it a lot easier to investigate the organisms that live here. Hi, welcome to the tide pool. We were lucky enough to be visited by someone who works with the Seattle Aquarium. This is Jane, and she has some facts about sea stars to share with us.
Hi, it's great to have you here today.
Thanks.
And we've got some sea stars down here that are pretty big. And you know how they have 5 arms, right? Well, did you know that at the end of each arm is their eye? Isn't that wild?
Sea stars have eyes or light receptors at the end of each arm. These light receptors are specific to this animal, and it allows the animal to gather information about the environment around it. Life in the tide pool is pretty dangerous, and sometimes a sea star loses an appendage. But don't worry, if a sea star loses an arm, it can grow another one back in its place. Another external adaptation of the sea star is its tube feet. Each arm has hundreds of tiny tube feet that can hold on tight to slick surfaces, catch and hold prey, and are used for movement, as you can see in this time-lapse video. I found. Let's ask Jane from the Seattle Aquarium what it is.
So you found a Dungeness crab. These Dungeness crabs spend a lot of time buried in the sand where it hides while it's waiting for its new shell to harden. You know, they lose their shell when they get a little bit bigger, just like when you change your pajamas. In the spring, the species often can be found in the low intertidal, buried in the sand and in tide pools.
The external body parts of a crab each have a function to help the crab survive in the tide pool ecosystem. These appendages allow the crab to hunt for prey and protect itself from predators. These claws or pincers are great for grasping and defense. These legs allow the crab to walk sideways, which allow for a quick and sneaky getaway. And this shell covering of the crab is hard and acts like body armor. The external body parts each have functions that work together to help this animal thrive in this environment. As I was observing and exploring, I found another type of crab. This is a kelp crab. Kelp is a type of sea plant, and these crabs love to eat it. This crab's color depends on how much kelp they eat. The more kelp they eat, the more their shells turn this brownish-greenish color. This color change adaptation allows them to camouflage where they feast. Check it out! I found a crab that was right in the middle of eating some kelp. This kelp crab has a missing leg. Don't worry, another adaptation of this animal is its ability to grow back its lost appendages, just like the sea star. This adaptation comes in handy for legs that may have been lost to predators or even other crabs. Is that a sea snail? Wait, no, it's not. At first, I didn't even notice this crab because of its unique adaptation and behavior. It's a hermit crab. Hermit crabs live in the shells of sea snails. This behavior helps protect the crab from predators. When we take away the shell of a hermit crab, we see that it has a soft abdomen and body. Hermit crabs use a behavior of making homes from the shells of snails. But don't worry, these snails were already dead and they no longer needed this shell. As the hermit crab grows, it must search for a larger shell. This shelter-seeking behavior helps this animal to adapt to the tide pool ecosystem. Closely at this rock. It's full of animals. What do I mean? Well, these crater-like shells are barnacles. A barnacle has an external, hard, circular shell structure that protects it. It spends most of its life attached to a hard surface in the tide pool, mostly rocks. Barnacles are filter feeders. They collect small pieces of food in the water using its internal, feathery appendage. You can see this feathery structure best when the barnacle is underwater. These blob booger-looking objects on the rocks are really animals. These are sea anemones. Underwater, they open to reveal their tentacles. When removed from the water, they pull their tentacles inside. These animals have external adaptations of tentacles that sting and retrieve, catch, and eat prey. When the tide is low and the water recedes, the sea anemone pulls its tentacles inside to protect it from drying out and to protect it from other damage. These tentacles also have a function to sense their surroundings. As you can see, sea anemones come in many different bright colors. It was fun to spot them both in and out of the water, although out of the water they looked a bit creepy. What is that? Is that a snake? Is it an eel? Let's ask Jane.
You guys just found a crescent gunnel. This wriggling fish feeds on a variety of small bivalves and nips off feeding appendages of barnacles.
Jane also explains how the gunnel has a behavior to help keep its young safe.
It wraps its body around eggs to protect it from predators until the eggs hatch. It's pretty common and it's usually found in tide pools where you found this one.
This gunnel also has a behavior that it can remain out of water and breathe air. Its body is adapted for the change in tides, so at low tide, it can even survive if there's very little water around. And another adaptation is its eel-shaped body. This allows this animal to move very quickly away from predators in low levels of water. Just watch as this one takes off. Today, we learned about the different organisms that live in the tide pool, and how these organisms are adapted both in behavior and body parts to survive in the tide pool. The next time you're at the tide pool, observe carefully, be patient, and give everything a close look. You never know what you're going to find or experience in the tide pool.
I said it's fun and stupid.
Yep.
This whole trip is fun and stupid.